share it. Come on up and I'll pray for you. Lord Jesus, thank you for Jared and for his family and for their obedience to you, Lord Jesus. Help us to have open ears so that we can hear and willing hearts so that we will obey. In Jesus' name we ask and pray. Amen.
Hello again. I don't know if some of you might remember me or remember last time I was here. Probably, when was the Missions Conference? A couple months ago?
Yes, September.
I was here for the Missions Conference. my timing's bad because I had to go to Indonesia, shave the beard. So since the beard is gone, now my world is destroyed. I don't know what day it is. But yeah, so some of you might not recognize me because of that. First time you saw me was with the beard, and I had to shave it for paperwork reasons when I was in Indonesia. So now I'm in the dead winter of Michigan without a beard. So, but this is, I show you this picture because this was taken yesterday. I don't know if you guys have had those. I would tell you this is like one of my least favorite things to do is family picture day or whatever you want to call this scenario. You might have had many stories of trying to get your kids to smile at the same time. And yes, this picture turned out all right, but this was the real look of the day. Like this is what reality was about. I don't know, maybe like an hour and a half worth of trying to take pictures. And this was dealing with kids, so this is our Christmas picture. But yeah, I would like to pray real quick if that's all right with you, and we'll get started from there. Dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for the time with the family and of a church body here in Dalton. And God, thank you for allowing me to be a part of this. And God, I just pray that we can look to you for encouragement and for your grace. And God, thank you so much for allowing us to be a part of your family and to serve you and make you known all around the world and here in Dalton also. And God, we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Yeah, a little bit about myself. We live in Hastings, so not too far from here. And my dad is a pastor at Hastings Baptist Church. But I am not a pastor. I am a tribal missionary, and there's a complete difference. I'm not one to be up front, you know, preaching, and that's not, yes, I'm a PK, a pastor's kid, but I'm one to be in the tribe, among tribal people out in the middle of nowhere, and that's kind of where God has gifted me in. And so, but thank you for inviting me to come here, and hopefully we can kind of come together and just be able to learn through what I have for you, of what God has kind of brought to my attention, and just, and I'm glad that you guys are a church of, you guys are open, you know, you're open to share, and I might not call on anybody specific, but I'll, as we're approaching this text, and as we're going through it, yeah, I would love to hear some feedback of some of the things that we'll be talking about today, and basically, we're going to be touching, I know it's like the spirit of Christmas, and this is almost like I'm being a Grinch, because I'm talking about discouragement, but I want to talk about the cure for discouragement, and we're going to look at some of these verses here, and I know, like through what you guys were talking about through prayer requests and testimony time, Christy, thank you for sharing some of the things that you shared, and Christy, right? Okay. I don't want to say your name wrong. But yeah, Christy was mentioning some of the things that and among others, we're sharing the reality of things, and I think that's awesome. And this is kind of a subject that we'll be touching based on, is not just difficulties, but taking another step farther into discouragement. But a while ago, there was a planetarium in New York City that sent an advertisement to many of the newspapers in New York saying that they're looking for people to, like, they're looking for people that send in their applications, those who want to go to another planet and wanted to start another life in another planet. And within a few days, they were surprised that there was thousands of people that handed their applications in. And among those applications, they gave it to a group, a panel of psychologists. And the psychologists gathered all this information and these applications, and they narrowed down to this. People were willing to, they wanted to start a new life on another planet because they were so discouraged about this life that they're living in. And maybe some of you would, I won't take any, show any hand, but maybe some of you would be, I would be the one that would sign that application or send an application in and want to start a new life because you're in that position of discouragement, because you're thinking this life is, I'd rather start another one on a different planet. Or maybe some of you just like the adventure part of it and say, hey, I'd like to go crazy on another planet. But this is reality. This is the reality of us, discouragement. And you know what? Discouragement is a killer. We, like on a daily basis, we tend to have discouraging times. And that discouraging time can affect us. And you know what? Discouragement also causes many people to leave the church, to leave the relationship with God. And we even know, and even as this church body, you guys are without a pastor. As a church body, I'm sure your discouragement right now is not having a pastor or looking for a pastor. And that can affect the church body too. And I hope that that as a church body, you can even become more unified and become more, just grow together. And then some of you, that it just causes some of you to come out of your comfort zone and be doing other things that normally you wouldn't do, but because there's no pastor or because you're at the church, you want to see things grow and flourish together. That's what's causing some of you to do, is get out of your comfort zone. But, and there's stats out there that when pastors, within 5 years, what is it? Let me read this so I don't get it wrong. It says half the pastors don't last more than 5 years. And some of them just lay down their Bibles and just give up religion in general, or give up the whole relationship with God. And then you know what about missionaries? There's a stat out there that says that 75% of missionaries that come home within 3 years, they don't ever go back. 75%. And here, we were in Indonesia for 3 years, and we're back here in furlough, and we're planning on going back. So we pray that God, that we're a part of that 25% that does return, and that we do make a career life commitment of 15 plus years. But so I say these stats because this is the reality of our life. Pastors, missionaries, and even people. People with their discouragements among the relationship with God. But you know what? God did not bring, that was the discouragement, and the life that state of discouragement is not from God. Because in 2 Timothy 1:7, it says, "For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind." This is what God brought us, power, love, and sound mind. So obviously from that verse, it shows that discouragement is not part of that. Discouragement is not part of that. And the Bible teaches us that it is possible to win the battle over discouragement, and that God has a plan to deliver you from the effects of that. And in fact, these verses that we'll touch today, I hope that it will accomplish that, that it will give you a direction and or just some encouragement if you are wrestling through this, or if you know someone that's close to you that's wrestling through this. All right, I'm going to read these verses. If you don't have your Bibles, you can read along with me. Hebrews 12, 1 through 3. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning his shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endures such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Today, we're just going to focus on verse 1. But I think, I would encourage you after today, kind of go through verse 2 and verse 3 and kind of show the follow-up effects of how to go through this life of discouragement. But as some of you might know or already know or don't know, this passage touched about the race, the Christian life of running the race. And it's a very common sermon that pastors will give is running the race. And that's not exactly where I'm going to go with this, but through these passages, it's running the race. And this is such a good analogy of our life here on earth, is running the race. So I have, if you guys don't know me very well, I'm a very simple guy. And I'm going to give you a very simple 4 points of what to walk away with these passages. And the first one is, be encouraged. Be encouraged. As we talk about this heavy topic of discouragement and some of the things that you're kind of wrestling through, what you're thinking in your mind, some of the discouragements you have, be encouraged. Because let's check out the first part of the first verse. Since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. Be encouraged because we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. If you go into chapter 11, the previous chapter, it's known as the Hall of Faith chapter. So if you check out that chapter, it shows all these people that have that are in the Hall of Faith. Like, there's this list of people that have gone through life, and they're considered the faithful people. So when it's saying we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, it's referring to the chapter before that they just talked about, these people that have accomplished life. And these people are the ones that show, like, the good report of these people that have lived life by faith. And these people are examples that they went through discouraging times, and times that they could have said, you know what, this is it, I'm done. I'm done with this life. But these are the people that said, you know what, thank you God for bringing this, and thank you for, and they continue their faith and confidence in that God is in control. And if you look at those people, they're not people that are, it's not Jesus, it's not supernatural people. It's people just like you and I. They have the same desires. It's men and women in this chapter. They have the same desires, passions. They have the same kind of human nature that you and I have. And they have the same kind of struggles, if not worse than ours, that they went through in life. So these are everyday people. They went through life considered as a faithful people. So I encourage you guys to check out that chapter 2 and chapter 11 and kind of look at those people and some of the examples that they have lived through this life. You know, there's, aside from scriptures, there's been some of our, actually a pastor from our supporting church has said to us, like, man, you guys have gone through a lot. You have gone through a lot of difficulties. And it could have, basically he said, thank you for not throwing in the towel. And he was saying that you guys could have thrown in the towel, come back to America where it's a little bit easier than the life that we live in a tribe. And because we have gone through a lot with medical and just there's been so many things, but it's just been awesome. Like as we look at the things that God has brought or what the positives of what we're doing, it's just amazing that we're able, that we were chosen to be a part of God's work in the tribe and reaching this Dem people. And those of you that weren't in Sunday school, we're in a tribe called the Dem, and right now we're the first ones to ever learn their language outside of their tribe, and we're trying to basically learn the language and eventually have a church full of believers, just like you guys here. And that's the end goal that God has for us. And but be encouraged. Like there's witnesses of people in chapter 11, and there's even witnesses, people around you and your daily life that has shown faith, a faithful life. And there's also people that have shown a non-faithful life. So you have examples of what it is to be have a faithful life and a non-faithful life. All right, point two. Okay, be free. The next part of the verse says, let us throw off everything that hinders. Throw off everything that hinders, and this is where it comes into the runner. I don't know about you, but I hate running. I can't stand running, but if you give me a basketball, baseball, some kind of sport with a ball, I love it. I can run with that, but running in general, like I can't stand it. But the analogy is great because we can all imagine if, like you, like me, a non-runner, you can imagine what a runner looks like. And that's what our Christian life is going to be, or should be. Anything that hinders us from running the race well must be laid aside. Anything that hinders, anything that weighs us down. So some of the things that can weigh us down, all right, I'm going to bring some props to you guys. Okay, some people, and these are things that are not necessarily bad. And they're not bad. It's not a sports. I'm a sports guy. Sports can be something that can hinder, like us, anything that can take your time away from your relationship with God, anything that had more time and energy than Jesus is hindering. It's hindering our race, our Christian race through this life. So some of us love sports, like myself, and that can take us away from that. So as a runner, this is what I'll be carrying if that is part of my time and energy. Work. I'm sure many of you, a lot of your time and energy and stress and life is work. You constantly might think about work. You might be thinking about your boss. You might be thinking about your fellow employees or people that you work with and have constant struggles. And so work. Movies, TV and movies. I found out that the stat that an average person watches 5 hours a day of TV or movie. 5 hours a day, that's a long term. But so this is, as a Christian running the race, I am, maybe some of you guys are all about fashion. This is my way of being fashion. If I had the beard, I'd look so much better, right? But maybe some of you guys are all about your self-worth and wondering how people view you or how people think about you, or maybe these clothes are not good enough, my car, my house, all of these self-worth things that you're putting above what's important, what's your relationship with God. Does anybody have any examples that they want to share? I look at the clock wondering how we're doing on time, but as I'm gathering more Does anybody want to shout out some of the things that maybe you or others can have something hinder your life? And it doesn't have to be sin. It's just family. I mean, doesn't family take a lot of time? But it's also important, right? It's God wants us to value family and wants us to have that time with family. But obviously, He doesn't want you to throw away your family, and that's not what He wants. But He wants us to prioritize our relationship with Him. Okay. Next point, be pure. So as you see, I'm running right now through this race, and I'm carrying all these things. So be pure is the third part, and it's the next part that says, it says, let us throw off everything that hinders, and then this part, and the sin that so easily entangles. So now, this is where we gotta be real. And I know maybe some of you are looking at your spouse and like, yeah, listen to this guy right now, okay? Because
He's already done it.
So right now, let's not think about your spouse and how bad they are and how much they need to change. But like right now, this is where the rubber meets the road, in a sense. Like, check out your life. Like, dissect your life and realize what sin is affecting. Because some of the things that, you know, when you get, I don't know if there's any new believers here, or if there's I hope and pray that all of us are believers and followers of Christ, and maybe when you first became a Christian, you thought that you're not going to have any kind of struggles, or you thought that maybe you're not going to have any kind of sin, and it's just, life is going to be great, but obviously reality checked in, and we realized, and we all know that we all still sin, because sin wouldn't be sin if it was not enjoyable, and like that's why sin is because it's the temptations are there because of the enjoyment that we get out of that sin, or the selfishness, and like all of these things is a part of our life, whether we're Christians or not, like. We still struggle with that too. But some of the things that we can struggle with as a sin is maybe lusting. Lusting of the flesh, lusting of things. So here is this, my wife's beautiful purse as a symbol of lusting. Yeah, we got a lot of, like, we got computers, TV, movies, all this stuff that can be such a temptation to any of us. And I think churches don't talk much about this as far as, and I don't need to say exact words because I know there's kids in here, but, like, we know what we're talking about when we're seeing stuff on computers and TVs. And then, you know what? I'll explain that later, but. And then, so we'll go to the next, maybe anger. Some of you guys struggle with sin with anger. So we got this bag of anger. And there's other things like pride and bitterness. And so we got all this stuff. Here I am as a runner, running the Christian life, and I'm weighed down by all this stuff. All the stuff that's preventing me from running the race well. Yeah. I can walk with this. I can, you know, stroll through life, just walking and not really doing much damage and for this world, for kingdom purposes. Maybe you're just getting by just enough to get into heaven, but you're still carrying all this and you're not being as effective as a servant of God as you could be. So some of the things that we need to do to get rid of this stuff is to seek God for victory over these things. And also, you can be proactive. Some of the things that we do for the movies thing, or the lusting thing and all that stuff, Mel and I, we don't watch any movies with any kind of sexual content. Just plain and simple, anything that shows any kind of sexual content, There's a subscription, we don't watch it. So that's something about being proactive, of not having to challenge yourself with this temptation of the lust. And then some of the anger, I know some people that will never play board games or play sports because they have anger issues. And they realize that, I didn't realize I had that headband the whole time. They don't even play any kind of sports or anything because they know they can't handle it. They get so angry. So that's some of the ways that they're proactive with it. And then with pride, and then with bitterness, we have all this stuff that we're carrying. Maybe you got bitterness towards your family or spouse or your history with someone, and you got all this stuff weighing down. So do you think that that's what God wants us, servants of Him, to be living life like? Does He want us to be holy and carrying all this baggage and all the stuff that we just think about daily and stress and have this life of discouragement? No, He does not. Okay, the fourth point is to be persistent. That last part of the verse, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. So we need to run the race and course that God has set for us individually, not for, again, your spouse. You don't need to try to help your spouse run a better race. Like us specifically, God has the end goal for us of what He wants us to be. He wants to see His children to be like this. He has them all marked out and laid out for us. And He's putting in situations in life to help get you there. It's going to be through struggles. It can be through encouragement. But to get you that point, He's directing that route. And we need to learn not to quit. Like, be persistent. We always hear that the Christian life is not a sprint, but a marathon. And after being in a tribe, and after doing many survey trips of hiking through the mountains, I feel like the Christian life is that. It's not a sprint, it's also not a marathon. Because marathon, you kind of think of marathons as is relatively straight, and there's no bumps in the road. It's pretty, it's long, but it's pretty simple. Where if you ever come to the Dem tribe, and you try hiking, it's just super steep, super, super, wow, what's drop off? Or, sorry, I'm forgetting my English right now. It's like really high and deep, and then you got to cross rivers and bridges, and I just kind of view that as a Christian life where you're hiking up, you got to hike down, you're crossing rivers, this water is part of the temptation of trying to throw you off track, and these bridges, you got to go slow, and like, it's very difficult, and that's why I kind of see our Christian life is just up and down, sideways, and then just being hit by all these things that can throw you off track. But be persistent, and just getting up each time that we fall down. So, all in all, I want to say that just be steady. Just be steady. If you're a teacher, be steady. If you're a prayer warrior, a witness, or a church member, just be steady. Run your race and settle in for the long haul. Make up your commitment that this is your life, God is your life, and don't let any of these things slow you down. So be encouraged, be free, be pure, and be persistent. Are we going to fail? Yeah, we are. Is your spouse going to fail? Your kids? Yes. Is your fellow church member going to fail? Yes. Be persistent and continue. Strive. Just get up. Keep pulling forward. Because this Christian life is a long journey. And just be patient. We have one life to live here on earth. And I wish... I wish, I mean, I don't know about you, but I've always wished sometimes that I wish I knew how much longer I had here on earth. Like, for instance, if we had some kind of tattoo, something on our head showing the date that you were going to not be here anymore, or something that, like, almost like an expiration date that you could think, like, on a milk jug, there's an expiration date, and then I would have my expiration date. Just know that if you knew that, you'd know, you would live your life so much different, wouldn't you? And if you saw your fellow neighbor, the expiration date was only a week away, wouldn't you make sure that that was a believer, or wouldn't you treat them better? And they'd just be such a different, I don't know, I think that's kind of a weird analogy with the expiration date, but I just say that challenge your thinking, I guess. But yes, that's Hebrews 12:1, and I just wanted to share about the cure of discouragement, and you can check out verse 2 and 3, where Jesus is part of, is obviously the big part of that. And but yeah, thank you for letting me share what God brought to me, and I'd love to close in prayer, and let's go from there. Dear Jesus, thank you for your grace and allowing us to be able to get up and keep moving forward after we fail. And God, I just pray that we will have that strength to do that, and that that desire. And I just pray that we will look to the people in the 11th chapter, like all the people that lived a life of faith, and even though in the midst of all these discouraging times, and they were able to live life well and to finish it. And God, just pray for this church as they look for a pastor. Just pray that they'll lean on each other, encourage each other to live this race well, and just pray that we'll look at our lives as we dissect it and what's hindering us and weighing us down. And God, we love you. Thank you for letting us serve you, and just pray that we make your name great and glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen.